PowerPoint is about the material that is presented to you in the outline posted in D2L in the assessment basics module. I would recommend that you have the outline available to you, either print it out or have it on the screen with you so that you can take notes next to the concepts as I talk about them. What are you going to learn in this PowerPoint? You will learn what knowledge, skills, abilities, and other qualities mean to an industrial organizational psychologist. You will be able to describe the major methods of measurement that we use for hiring, selection, training, performance appraisal, many of the activities that an industrial psychologist engages in. We will also look at what's good and not so good about those assessment measurements. We are going to briefly look at how technology can facilitate or make assessment easier in any one of those tasks: hiring, promotion, training, a performance appraisal, etc. Let's first look at an example of a measurement that's often used in industrial psychology. Give me one moment, I am preparing the video. Takes a little while, and I apologize for this time. You might think that that was a completely inappropriate way to conduct an interview, but when we start looking at the aspects of measurement, in certain circumstances, depending upon what you're looking for and what the position is requiring, that might actually be an appropriate way to interview somebody. Let me find my PowerPoint again. So the first huge activity that really initiated assessment on a grand scale was when the US Army needed to get ready for World War I and had a ton of recruits and needed to know where to put them. And so they decided to figure out, well, what were their skills? Could they read? Did they have leadership ability? Did they have mechanical ability? And since there were thousands and thousands of them, they needed to have some sort of standardized, efficient way of doing it. And so assessment for placement really was initiated by the World War I effort. We use the terms assessment and testing as if they meant the same thing. We use them interchangeably, but they aren't actually the same thing. Assessment is a broader category of activities in which testing can be one of those activities. Assessment is measurement. You may interview, you may give them a test, you may observe them, you may have them do a work product. All kinds of different measures can go into the assessment process, testing being one of them. But why would we do assessment? Why would we administer a test or an interview? We're always going to be making a decision of some kind in industrial organizational psychology. And in fact, any kind of psychological assessment has as its goal making a decision about someone. when we look at it from an industrial psychology perspective, we're either trying to figure out whether to hire somebody or not, where to place them in the organization. Are they doing a good enough job to be promoted or to get a pay raise? Do they require development? Have we selected them for leadership, as an example? All of these are decisions about a person. And in order to make the best decision, we want to gather data that will enable us to do that. So what are we going to be gathering data on? We're going to be gathering data on knowledge, which is what the K stands for. We want to know, what does the person need to know to do the job successfully? We are going to measure their skills. What does the person need to be able to do for job success? So the difference between knowledge and skills is that an individual, let's say in a computer technician position, would need to have knowledge of programming language and then be able to use a computer, which is a skill in addition to having that general knowledge of how computers work, etc. Abilities are different from skills and knowledge in that we are trying to measure what the person is capable of learning to do in order to be able to do the job well. So this individual who got this job may have knowledge of computer programming, be able to use a computer, and be perhaps because of that, as well as past experience, have the ability to learn how to repair a computer, expand on their skills. They don't have to take steps back and get that knowledge or acquire that skill. They already have it. But is that all it takes in order to be able to be a computer technician? Probably not. There are probably other qualities as well that are needed for job success. When we think about a computer technician, they probably need to have attention to detail as a value for them, or organization, or checking for accuracy, that they need to go through the entire program or the entire computer to make sure that everything had been repaired. So KSAs, as it's often referred to, sometimes you'll see the O in places where people don't want to forget that there are other qualities in addition to KSAs that the job might require. So we talked about what the goal of assessment is. Let's look more into detail about that. So as I had mentioned already, we want to measure a person's knowledge, skills, abilities, and other qualities to be able to make a good data-informed decision about them. Those assessments need to be valid. Validity, I could teach a whole course on validity. It is a psychometric property of measurement in psychology. And the fundamental definition of validity is that it is the amount of evidence that is available to support the interpretation of a test score or the measurement result. Let's say you're not using a test. Let's say you're using an interview, for example. So let's go back to that crazy interview that we watched at the beginning. And let's say that we were giving the guy scores for his ability to respond to the stressors that the interviewer was giving him. The non sequitur questions, the weird challenges, the intrusive questions, maybe the interviewee's responses, both verbal and nonverbal, you know, his behavior as well as his speech, was rated on a scale of 1 to 5 in terms of handling stress, being appropriate in inappropriate situations, you know, whatever was being measured in that interview. And we came up with a composite score. This gentleman didn't really react in any kind of emotionally explosive way until the very end, and that seemed appropriate. Let's say he got a 45 out of 50. And so we then say, he handles stress well on the job. That's our interpretation of the score. Well, what data do we have that back up that interpretation? What data tell us that the score really does mean that, and it is a valid measure of job stress coping? And so that's what we're talking about when we talk about validity. And there are various ways of going about gathering that data that show you are confident in your interpretation of the assessment score or the test result. Overall, the validity is called construct validity. All measures are attempting to put a numerical quantity on an idea or a concept, also known as a construct. So again, from the crazy interview at the beginning of our talk, we were measuring, you know, ability to cope with job stress, challenges from irrational individuals. This might actually be a mental health technician interview. Can an individual handle, you know, questions that really don't pertain to anything at all and inappropriate questions? So that's the construct that we're trying to measure in that person. We would attempt to seek validity information by a couple of ways. We could look at the content of the measure. And so when you look at the behavior of the interviewer, the questions he asked of the guy, his behavior itself, his how he looked unhappy and put off by the interviewee, that when we look at the content of the measure, does it seem to reflect what it is we're trying to get at? And I would say, yes, if that is truly what we were measuring, the content of that interview has content validity. Content validity is often pursued in school achievement tests. So the assessments that you're taking in class here, in this class, should have content validity. I should be asking you on the quizzes what I'm requiring you to read about. Some of you may have experienced tests that seemed to have no content validity at all. You either get a review or you're told to read chapters 2 and 3 and you come in for the test and the test is not about chapters 2 and 3 at all, or the review doesn't cover the same stuff that was on the test. So that test has no content validity. It's not reflecting the concepts you were told it was going to measure. Another way of getting data to support the interpretation of a test score or an assessment result is called criterion related. What that means is, does the test score reflect some level of ability or knowledge or skill that this person currently has? And to what level? So as an example, let's say that we gave people who currently work in mental health that interview, and they scored at about a 45. And we see that they are good copers in the mental health environment. We can then say that the test probably measures, or that test score probably means they are good copers, because seeing good copers score that high, those who achieve that criterion, we interpret it that way. People who do well on a math test and then show that they have math skills in real life, I would say that the test score, if I interpret that as you have good math skills, it's because it's related to your ability to actually do math in your real life. People who do very poorly on the math skill test, and I've observed that they can't make the right change or pay the bill appropriately, then I'm accurately able to say this score does measure math ability. Poor math scorers don't do well in math in their lives. Same thing with the mental health interview. If somebody did very poorly in that interview, talked back, was unable to answer in calm and controlled ways, flipped out more than the interviewer did, and they were not good mental health technicians, they did very poorly on the job, then I would also say, hey, that test score does seem to mean ability to cope with stressors in a mental health job. So one could look at the content of a test, one could correlate the test score with some real world example of that construct, and that would all be data toward validity. Measurements should be valid. The scores should mean what you claim that they mean and have evidence to back that up. Tests should also be reliable. Reliability is basically accuracy. How much error is in your measurement? And you want to make it as little as possible. You want to make your measurement be as accurate as possible. And you see that little formula, X equals T plus E. X stands for the observed score. So the scores that you see your test takers getting are the observed score. They are made up of the true amount of the concept or construct you are attempting to measure. So again, let's go back to the mental health interview. We're trying to measure coping in a mental health environment. And so the observed score that the person gets on our interview measure would be a combination of their true ability to cope with mental health stress, plus some amount of error in the measurement. We want to make E as small as possible so that what we're tapping into when we do measure is only pure T, the true amount of whatever it is we're attempting to measure. Well, how would we figure out if a test is reliable or accurate? One way is to give the test and then give it again at some later date. If we're measuring a construct that is expected to stay the same over a period of time, an example of that would be intelligence. Intelligence is relatively stable over shorter periods of time, 1 or 2 years. So we give people an intelligence test, we give it to them again a year later, and we compare the scores. If they are accurate, they should be the same over those two test periods. If someone scored 105 this year, and then a year later scores approximately at 105 again, then the test is probably reliable. That method of measuring reliability is called test retest, and it is often used in measures of ability or other constructs that are expected to stay the same over time. There are, however, constructs we would expect to change. Depression is a clinical syndrome where people go in and out of depressive episodes. And so if we gave a test of depression or a measure of depression, and then even 2 months later, gave it again, the score might change, but it would be expected to. Depression is episodic. So what do we do then? Well, we can give the test once and then divide the test items in some way to make two mini versions of that test and correlate those two halves. That would be called internal consistency. What we're doing there is we're kind of theoretically making two time periods. All the odd numbered items were given at this one time and all the even numbered items were given, you know, at the same time, but it's considered a second testing time. So for constructs or ideas or qualities of people we expect to change over time, especially if they change really quickly, we would pursue reliability by conducting an internal consistency experiment. There are some constructs, and this is very common in industrial psychology, where people are being measured by raters. A lot of you have jobs where you're evaluated by the supervisor saying how well you're doing on the job. They're rating you in some way. Well, are those ratings accurate? Are they reliable? And so we would have more than one person rate you on the same scale. They would be using the same rating scale. And then we would correlate the two raters' opinions of your performance. If they are relatively the same, then that rating scale is pretty reliable. It's accurate. And that would be called inter-rater reliability. So validity and reliability are critical qualities of the measures themselves in order for us to be confident that they are accurately, reliably measuring what we think they are measuring. They are valid. So what types of measures are out there that might construct an assessment activity? Psychological tests are a very common approach to assessment. And we're going to briefly go through the various kinds of psychological tests that are often used in industrial psychology. In addition to tests, psychological tests, industrial organizational psychologists may also use biographical information as a measure of whether or not to hire someone, promote them, pay them more, train them more, fire them. We may also use interviews, which we've already briefly talked about. We may also use work samples. And a very common approach in which we might use any combination of all of these is the use of an assessment center, which, by the way, is a very popular place for industrial psychologists to find work. That is largely where they do work if they're not doing research or teaching. So let's look at psychological tests. When we think about the psychometric properties that I just talked about, reliability and validity, one common general rule is that the more items a test contains, the more reliable a test is. Some of you may do woodworking and are familiar with the phrase, measure twice, cut once. You measure it twice to make sure that you have measured it accurately before you cut it. So the more times you measure, the more accurate you're going to be in that measurement. And reliability also is part of the evidence for the validity of a test. A test score is going to mean what you claim it means if it is accurate. There's at least that part in part of the measurement. A reliable test is evidence of possibly a valid test. Right? Let's look at one example of an oral test of personality. I'm going to have to probably stop the share for a second.
Football season is here.
What are we doing here? I thought you were inspecting the laboratory.
Psychological evaluation of all employees. Dr. Biedemann, standard operating procedure. Question two.
Take long?
That's question 76.
Okay.
Question two. Which of the following would you say best describes your personality and what you are like? Direct and impersonal, enthusiastic and focused, stealthy and perverse, fat and awful, little and large, or Mike and Bernie Winters?
I don't think any of them.
Well, I think this one.
Sorry, which one?
Yeah, oh, sorry, Dr. Biedemann. Participants' answers are confidential. Question three. Which, on a scale of 1 to 5, with 1 being often and 5 being the largest, would you say is most applicable to you?
Are they all like this?
3.
3?
Great.
What? I didn't say that.
Question four. Well, I think we already know the answer to that one.
Josh, now you'll be disqualified.
Disqualified from what?
Question five, true or false?
Dr. Biedemann, true or false?
False?
Right.
Well, true.
You can't change your mind now. It's in the system. You'll have to write after this address.
I'm sorry, which address?
This address.
Yeah. Any chance for more go?
I can't sit around all day playing Cardi Cardi face to face with you, Dr. Question 6.
Again, psychological tests can take many forms. We just saw a psychological test in the form of an interview. They can be paper and pencil, they can be tasks, they can be group on computer, they can all take many formats. So a psychological test is a standard, which means given to everyone identically, a standard set of items that are administered in a controlled environment. You don't want there to be individual circumstances that are different for everyone who's taking the test, because that will add to the error in your measurement. So as an example, if a test is given paper and pencil to some of the applicants or some of the people who are applying for promotion, you can't then give it to another set of people on computer who are also applying for promotion, because those circumstances are different and might affect the performance on that measure. What are the characteristics of a psychological test? Well, we already talked a little bit about this one. We can give them individually or we can give them in a group. Giving psychological test in a group obviously is going to be more efficient. You can measure 500 people at one time. And because of having only one person needed to proctor them, that it's going to be cheaper. However, there are issues of test security. People can walk off with the test. If it's an ability or a knowledge test, it might be more difficult to discover who's cheating, and that might be a problem. Civil service tests are group-administered psychological tests. Individual-administered tests are more informative because you can look at the person's behavior as they approach the tasks to the test, since you are only proctoring one individual, but they can be very expensive. An example in industrial psychology would be the in-out basket test. There are tests that have different item formats. One type of item format is the closed item format, the closed question. And you're very familiar with those because that's what multiple choice exams are. You are given a task that demands that you select from the already available answers. You do not have to come up with one on your own. Multiple choice, true, false, matching, those are all closed ended. The interview where questions are asked like, do you smoke? Where the answer is just yes or no, that's also closed ended items. An example in industrial psychology is a personality test called the Minnesota Multiphasic Personality Inventory, or the MMPI, which has historically been used to evaluate individuals for certain positions. Open-ended items are also called free recall. And again, you're familiar with those if you've ever taken an essay test, where the responses are not provided for you, but rather the demand of the task is to answer a question with a lengthy answer. Describe the circumstances that led up to the war of 1812. Explain what validity is and how to go about acquiring evidence of it. Those would all be open-ended questions. Lots of times interview questions are that way. Tell me about an experience you had where you had to confront a coworker for unethical behavior and how you handled it. That would be an open-ended question. An example, and that would be a good example in industrial psychology as an interview question. I have a clinical example here in my chart, the Rorschach inkblot technique. The answers to the inkblots are infinite. People can see just about anything in them. So they're definitely open-ended items. Tests can be given in different formats, in different physical formats. There are paper and pencil tests where the person basically responds to pre-printed items. I would include computer tests in here as well. When you take the GRE on the computer, that's what would be historically called a paper and pencil test. It's all pre-printed, you're just responding to items, and even open-ended items. An essay test is a paper and pencil test. They are more efficient, they're easier to score. You can sometimes put them through a machine and the machine can score them. An example from industrial psychology is the Strong Campbell Interest Inventory, where I'm going to be expecting you to take some version of that in a later module. Versus performance assessments or performance tests, where you are actually engaging in some kind of behavior that will be evaluated either for your accuracy, for your speed, for other qualities of that behavior. An example of a performance test would be the Purdue Pegboard, which we will talk about in a little bit more detail, again, either later on in this unit or in another unit. The person basically has to put together screws, washers, dowels, nuts, that kind of thing, and they have to do it in a certain order and in a certain time period. So they are doing something, they are performing. Another dimension upon which psychological tests can fall is the power versus speeded dimension. Power tests are usually organized where easier items are the initial items and then gradually increase to greater and greater difficulty where people cannot get them all correct. An example of that in industrial psychology would be the oral defense of your dissertation when you graduate from a doctoral program that trained you for a specific job. The questions that your defense team asks you get more and more difficult. Intelligence tests are actually a combination of power and speed. The power tests are organized such that the initial items are very easy. What are the colors of the American flag? To then very difficult. What is the population of the United States? Lots of people don't know that. Speeded tests are basically tests that are timed. They are looking at speed and accuracy. Typing tests are speeded tests. You have to, you know, your score is how many words did you accurately type in a minute? And psychological tests can fall anywhere in these combination of dimensions. So let's look a little bit at ability tests. Ability tests in general are measures of your capacity to learn. What are you going to be able to learn? They often take the form of cognitive ability tests, and they can either be very broad, which a general intelligence test would be, if you're familiar with the Wechsler scales or the Stanford-Binet. Those two very popular measures are tapping into broad capabilities. There are also some cognitive ability tests that measure very narrow abilities, numerical abilities, verbal abilities, that kind of thing. In industrial psychology, the personnel test for industry is a narrow test. It's very brief, 25 minutes. You can administer it by a group. So it's a very popular test because it's brief and cheap. So let's look at two examples of that, which measure the narrow abilities of numerical and verbal ability. So here we're looking at a person's ability to do math with decimals and a person's ability to detect categories of words. When we go back and we think again about validity and reliability, if we are expecting a measure, let's go back to this slide here. We are expecting a measure to measure numerical ability. And we look at this item, this numerical ability item, it's given to the test taker in words. And so that item not only measures numerical ability, it also measures reading ability, reading comprehension. You have to know how to read and you have to know how to comprehend how to read. And so that numerical ability test, as we see here, is not a pure measure of numerical ability. So the test score might also be affected by reading ability and reading comprehension ability, which would lead to error and it would reduce the validity of the interpretation of the score as a pure numerical ability score. So there needs to be tests that are nonverbal and can still measure abilities. The Beta 2, which the Army used for World War II when they had a lot of recruits who were illiterate. And so here you could still administer it in a group, but you had to give the instructions verbally. So you see the instructions where it says, ask examinees to mark the shortest distance through the maze without crossing any lines. And then coding, you tell the test taker to label the figures with their corresponding numbers. See if they can match the codes up. Okay. We do know that ability tests, verbal and nonverbal, are valid predictors of job performance. And what that means is that the test score correlates robustly, is closer to one than it is to zero, correlates with job performance. And it makes sense. You know, people have to be able to think, comprehend, understand what's asked of them on the job and understand, comprehend, and be able to do them if they are cognitive tasks. And this is true across different kinds of jobs, not just specific jobs. Lots of industrial psychologists have done many, many studies and have found that ability tests are also fair, meaning that when they are used for selection, they are not leading to what industrial psychologists call adverse impact. And let's say we have a group of 100 people who have applied for a job, and 20 of them are African-American and 60 of them are women. And let's say we use a nonverbal test and we use it over and over and over again. And what we find is that we're always selecting white men. That would not be fair because verbal and ability levels are not correlated with gender or race. And yet the test is always picking white men. That would be problematic. So we know from the tests that are published and have been repeatedly used in the selection process that those tests are not picking up race or gender as a variable. The scores are not being affected by that. So in general, they are fair selection procedures. And thus they are useful because you are not discriminating against the applicant. And because it's correlated with job performance, it's helping you select the best person for the job. Not only cognitive ability is being tapped into when we're looking at ability tests, but psychomotor ability. And here we have a picture of the Purdue pegboard. And you can see how the individual needs to take items from these little trays and put them together in a specific pattern all the way across the pegboard. What is this measuring? It's measuring the ability to manipulate objects, especially small ones, and the ability to coordinate one's senses with movement, basically called eye-hand coordination in this instance. Well, what would the Purdue pegboard be used for? It would be used for jobs that require individuals to put small things together. Car assembly lines, any assembly line where an individual has to assemble objects in a particular order pretty quickly and accurately. So the Purdue pegboard is a wonderful selection measurement. And by wonderful, I mean it is valid and it is reliable. It measures accuracy and speed, as I have already mentioned. The scores are based on speed and accuracy. A person is given two trials where the scores are kept, but they're not used for anything. They're just ways of familiarizing the person with the procedure and getting them sort of into the flow, because that's what you really want to measure. When they're up to speed, so to speak, when they're doing their optimal performance, how well are they doing? So they are given several trials first, and then we start to score them based on their speed and accuracy. And that score is then used to correlate with job performance. Achievement tests, on the other hand, are what the person has already accomplished. That's why it's called achievement. Not what they're capable of doing, but what have they already achieved, their proficiency. So what we're looking at here is prior knowledge and skills that they already have and are using to perform tasks. So getting away from cognitive ability for a second and looking at mechanical ability, the Bennett Mechanical Comprehension Test measures what a person already knows about the mechanical world. So these are three items that are on the Bennett. The top one depicts a picture and asks which person carries more weight. And if the individual wants to respond, they both carry it equally, then they should say C. Which room has more of an echo? Which would be better shears for cutting metal? So obviously, especially with that third item, it's not what could you learn, but rather what do you already know? An individual would already have to have knowledge of metal cutting to know which tool would be the best. It's B, by the way. So those are ability tests. Personality tests measure personality, right? Either your entire personality or one or two elements of it. Well, what's personality? Personality is a relatively stable pattern of thoughts, feelings, and behavior. across environments and time. It's not totally static. You know, you think about what you're like in different environments. In a classroom, many of you are more subdued than you would be at a party. Some of you are the same, are just as subdued at a party as you are in a classroom. And that speaks of your personality characteristics. Some of you are more changeable than others across different environments. That in and of itself is a personality trait. We do see that personality is also relatively stable over time. So what you're like now at whatever age you are now, you're probably going to be a lot like that in 5 years. Are you going to be exactly like that? No. And thus the word relatively stable. So personality is constructed of thoughts, feelings, and behaviors, which is everything that psychology studies. It's the totality of who we are. We do know that personality characteristics do correlate with job performance for some jobs. A very good example of that is the personality trait of sociability. This is an individual who is oriented toward people, likes to talk to them. People like talking to this person. They do well in social environments. That kind of individual is going to perform better in a sales job than somebody who scores very low on a sociability scale, who's not interested in interacting with other people, who doesn't like people, who doesn't have that social skill available to them because they haven't practiced it or learned it and have no interest in doing that. So personality is a critical piece of evaluation in industrial psychology. There is one measure called the International, well, it's actually it measures the big five factors of personality. These researchers, Goldberg et al., have made it available to individuals. And so the website is called the International Personality Item Pool. I have this website link on the outline that hopefully you're following with me. And if it isn't there, it is there. You can click on it and you can take either the full version of what's commonly administered, which does take a little while, or an abbreviated version. And there's a whole host of instructions and what you're getting into and what you're providing permission for, because these are researchers and they do want to use your data. So just make sure you read that very closely before you take that test. And you will get extensive results for free. It is free. One of the things that's critical to understand and pay attention to and be cautious of when you are measuring personality in any arena, let alone the industrial arena, is that there is a tendency for people to attempt to fake good. And what that means is that they are trying to come off on the personality measure as better than perhaps they really are. You want to put your best foot forward. On some of these measures, on some of the personality measures, and the MMPI is one example of that, there is a scale embedded in the test itself that detects a pattern of attempting to fake good. Some argue that that threatens the validity of the test. If a person is trying to put their best foot forward, then maybe they're not telling you what they're really like. And so the test is a measure of that best presentation rather than what the person is really like. Others in industrial psychology argue, well, if they get a good score, a high score on faking good, that means they know how to present themselves well. They do know what the social expectations are. And perhaps they may do that at the job, which would obviously be needed for frontline workers, people who are the ones that the public mostly sees, receptionists, secretaries, salesmen, professors, presenters, trainers, any individual who is the face of the company might need to have good presentation skills. And so a scale like faking good might actually be tapping into that. And so a high score on that scale might not necessarily be a bad thing. So it's an argument. If you find yourself in that argument at work, if you are an industrial psychologist, perhaps a bit of research correlating that scale with job performance would answer it for your particular company. One question that needs to be asked of all these kinds of measures is how relevant is the personality qualities that you are measuring to the job itself? And that's the example that I brought up with sociability and sales. You can't just measure personality because you want to find out what the person is like. It's actually against the law. You have to show that the test itself, whatever you're using to make decisions about people, is correlated with the purpose of those decisions. And so you want to be able to look at those correlations. What's problematic, however, is that there might be another variable that's causing those two things to correlate with each other. So again, if we look at the example of sociability and sales, perhaps what's really going on underneath both of those variables, the ability to sell well and being sociable, is what psychologists call Machiavellianism, the ability to manipulate individuals for your own personal gain. So what might come across as sociability, which is correlated with this Machiavellianism, and sales, is actually that both of those variables are correlated with Machiavellianism. So, you know, is it of concern that you are hiring a manipulator? Maybe not when it comes to sales, but if you want to put that person in a leadership role, you might want to think twice about that, for they would only be manipulating the subordinates in order to gain for their own personal gain. And that's not good leadership qualities. So you want to dig deeper under that correlation between personality characteristic and job performance and find out what's really going on. More recently, probably in the last 10 or 15 years, psychologists in general and industrial psychologists in particular have looked at this variable of emotional intelligence. Basically what it is, it's the ability to control your emotions, to recognize how you're feeling, and also to be able to recognize those emotions in other people and respond to them appropriately. So again, we go back to that crazy interview we saw at the beginning. The interviewee, Michael, also known as John, had high emotional intelligence. He was able to control what he was feeling for the most part and respond appropriately to the inappropriate emotions of the interviewer. Some people claim that the scores on a scale of emotional intelligence also are tapping into social skills. Is the individual more socially skilled? Are they aware of and able to control their impact on others? So we already start to see some questions about the validity of the score on an emotional intelligence scale. What does it really mean? Does it also mean that they're more able to work with colleagues? Do they get along better with them? Are they better in supervisory positions because they can exert better leadership? These are all questions because those have not been cleared up. And so again, in the work of an industrial psychologist, when a company says, hey, we'd like to use a scale of emotional intelligence because we know this about it, you might want to bring up these questions. Okay. We do know that there is a tendency in some instances, certain jobs that you can predict job performance based on a score of emotional intelligence. But look at that correlation, 0.16. Remember that correlations can range from 0 to 1. This correlation is certainly closer to 0 than it is to 1, but it's not 0. One of the things in industrial psychology is that you can't really expect correlations of tests with predictors or with current job performance to be robustly very close to 1. You're never going to get a validity coefficient of like 0.89, 0.92. You're happy when you get validity coefficients of 0.2. Carl. Research has shown that there is a correlation of emotional intelligence and the job performance of managers and the satisfaction of their subordinates, but that correlation is pretty small. So again, while it does help to make prediction, it's a very small part or a very small piece of what's going to help with that prediction. So again, there's just too little to go on to spend that amount of time measuring emotional intelligence, but it's going to crop up often because, you know, it's a hot topic kind of thing. So I would just be careful and cautious when someone recommends, hey, let's use this to predict job performance, selection, training, that kind of thing. Another type of test, in addition to the personality tests, the ability tests, are the integrity tests. So these are basically tests of values, not just the values held, but the values lived. As we all know, and it's certainly true of us as well as everybody else, what we say is important to us doesn't necessarily make its way to our behavior. As an example, how many of you have ever picked up pencils or pens from work, paper clips, any kind of office supplies, and taken them home? And yet you're against stealing, but that is exactly what you did. And so that's something companies obviously want to know about. Are you prone to any kind of unethical behavior, not just in your values held, but in the behavior exhibited? And that's what integrity tests do. Overt integrity is about the person's attitudes and their prior behavior, okay? And so they're being asked to agree or disagree with statements about ethical behavior. An example is not just, you know, do you think stealing is wrong? Lots of people are going to say, yes, I do. But something like this, do you think it's all right to lie if you know you won't get caught? People who say, yes, it's all right, you know, you're going to be a little concerned with their value system and their ethical behavior with the company, right? You might want to ask how often they have engaged in a number of behaviors that are ultimately against the company, both large and small. You know, have you ever walked away with office supplies, that kind of thing. So the overt integrity is directly asking about that ethical behavior, both in values as well as past behavior. Personality integrity tests measure personality characteristics that are associated with unethical behavior. An example on the MMPI is there are items that measure psychopathy, sociopathy, you know, if you're antisocial personality disorder, that kind of thing, where you have a blatant disregard for, you know, social rules, ethics, that kind of thing. And so it's not a direct measure, but it is highly correlated with one's potential for acting unethical. And so companies might do that in a more efficient manner, giving a personality test that measures the qualities of personality that are related to the job, as well as any kind of integrity needed for the job. These tests do have validity. They do predict absences and other counterproductive behaviors, stealing from the company, lying about, you know, goals and accomplishments, that kind of thing. And that is evidence that they are valid, because they correlate with the actual behaviors that the test score claims to mean, right? You're interpreting the score as a measure of ethics, and it correlates with ethical behavior. So in addition to all those kinds of tests, industrial psychologists are also interested in interests of the world of work, because it helps with selection, recruitment, training, placement, to know what the person's interests are vocationally, right? So basically, most of the popular ones, like the Strong Campbell, which I've already mentioned, it will match the responses on the items of the test with the responses of people who have been in a wide variety of occupations for at least 5 years. And so the claim there is your interests match up with people who pretty much have been successful since they've been able to hold that job for at least 5 years, and that you might like and be successful in that job as well. There are various personality theories, various vocational interest theories that drive these tests, One of which that I've already talked about, the Strong Campbell. Basically, Strong and Campbell made an argument that it was actually a vocational personality test, and that scores derived from that reflect these six personality types, being realistic, investigative, artistic, social, enterprising, and conventional. One of the assignments in this module is to take the Cal-U version of the Strong Campbell, which is called the Focus 2, and it will measure. It doesn't come up with these exact words, but it does give you a type by matching your interests with interests of people in a variety of occupations, and it generates a list of those occupations so that you can see if you're interested in all these things, that's what these people are as well, and you might like the jobs that they hold. So you can look at that in the module and do that assignment. In addition to all the testing we've already talked about, companies are interested in knowing whether people are using drugs. This has an effect on their job performance. It has an effect on safety and health of, you know, safety at work, health of the employees, that and the reputation of the company. So drug testing is pretty common. About 30 million Americans undergo drug tests each year. That's quite a percentage. And as you know, as I've just mentioned, most of it has to do with safety concerns, that there are jobs that accidents can lead to death. And so companies obviously want to be able to avoid that because they'll be responsible then, since they are responsible for the behavior of their workers. An example, air traffic controllers, pilots, obviously, bus drivers, anybody who is in control of dangerous equipment or potentially dangerous equipment. One of the controversies of drug testing is that it's unfair. Various psychologists and lawyers have argued that companies need to do validity tests to show that being on drugs does impair work performance, not to just assume that. I think the argument has some legs to stand on. They don't prevent people from taking cigarette breaks. They don't prevent people from taking coffee breaks. In fact, that's what they're called, coffee breaks. Some regulations require a 15-minute break in the morning block of time of work and the afternoon block of time of work. And so a person who's going outside and having one or two cigarettes and a cup of coffee is actually taking psychoactive substances. And those might impair their ability to perform the job that they have. They are both stimulants. And so they can certainly have an effect on job performance. So it's unfair to just pick illegal substances and claim without data that they affect job performance. And they're an invasion of privacy because these tests may pick up other things as well that the person is not giving permission to discover. And so there's quite a bit of controversy about it. In addition to tests, industrial psychologists gather information in order to make decisions about people based on biographical information, and probably the most common one that you've heard of is the resume. The resume includes information about the person's life, both historically as well as presently. And when we start talking about legal issues, there are allowable and prohibited information to be shared on a resume, as well as in an interview. There are questions you cannot ask about their biography. An application. A lot of us in our lives have filled out an application to get a job. That's a very common approach to selection. And it's basically asking some of the same stuff that a resume would ask. Please list prior jobs, locations, job duties. Certainly that's often included on a resume. Some companies use what's called a biographical information form. It's a specific set of questions about the person that don't really look like an application. And sometimes applicants say, what does this have to do with a job? Because they are created on a process called criterion keying. And what that means is that the content might not reflect what the job is all about, but experiments have shown that these questions are validly correlated with job performance. whether or not they look like they're related to the job. So to give you some examples, on the biographical information form, when you were in grade school and people were being picked for teams, when were you usually picked? Did you attend the high school prom? In your first full-time job, how often did you initiate conversation with your immediate supervisor? That one's work-related at least, but the other three, some of them are performance-related, some of them are social-related, but what if you are applying for manager of a Taco Bell and you're being asked these questions? You're like, what does this have to do with me being a manager? Research has shown that the answers to these questions are highly correlated with job performance. And so it is a valid way of seeking that information to make a decision whether to hire somebody or not to be a manager of a Taco Bell. But where you're going to run into problems is that the applicants will often experience it as being invasive and be reluctant or not cooperative, which you don't want to do because you want to get information from them, either both on this form, in an interview, on the application, and now they're already turned off by these questions. And the biggest reason why they're turned off, not only is because the questions are often very personal, but they don't seem to reflect the job that the applicant is applying for. And so again, it lowers the cooperation in the assessment process, which taints the data that you're getting if the person is not cooperative. So there's problems with that. In addition to tests and biographical information, as we've already seen, interviews, very common. People perceive them as being the most fair. They are not the most fair, actually. They lead to personal bias interference on the part of the interviewer, who may or may not be aware that they have these biases. Once they see the person's gender, race, age, ability status, all of which are irrelevant variables to the job, but they are there in the interview and they cannot be ignored. So while interviews are perceived to be fair, research tells us that they may or may not be. There are different kinds of interviews. The structured versus the unstructured interview refers to the type of questions that are being asked. It's basically, do you have a standard approach that you're taking to every single applicant? That would be the structured interview. You always ask every applicant, tell me about a time when you got into a conflict with a supervisor. What was that conflict about and how did you handle it? Every applicant is asked that. And then every applicant is asked a follow-up question. No matter what the story was, they might say, were you satisfied with that outcome? So every person who applies is given the same set of questions. An unstructured interview is they might start off with that question, but depending upon what the applicant says, that might lead to a variety of different questions that different applicants get. And so it's unstructured. It's basically an individual interview that is formed based on what's happening in the interview itself between the interviewer and the interviewee. Unstructured interviews do not have much reliability, which means they don't have much validity because they're so individualized. How can you tell that you are getting accuracy, right? When you start going off on a tangent with an interviewee, how do you correlate that with job performance? I've already talked about bias. Some people are aware of their biases. Most people aren't. I would argue that nobody is 100% aware of the biases that they hold and that everyone has biases, either biases in favor or against certain types of people on different characteristics. You know, the obvious ones are the isms, racism, sexism, that kind of thing. But there might be biases in terms of personal appearance. You know, someone reminds you of an ex and that individual doesn't get a fair shake in the interview because you're so angry being reminded of the relationship that you had with that individual. So physical appearance, fashion choices, cologne being worn, the smell of cigarette smoke. You know, you just never know what that's going to do to the interviewer. Another problem with interviews is that there is an interviewer effect. The interviewee is totally aware that they are being observed. And so being interviewed itself is going to affect the performance in that interview. And again, we can go back to that faking good. Are they able to put their best foot forward in that situation? Because we want that. We do want good presentation skills. Has anxiety so consumed them in this interview that they're unable to do that and thus not being given a fair shake to show what they can do because of that anxiety? And if anxiety is not related to the job at all, it is an interference in the ability to measure the applicant's qualities for the job. And then just sort of a practical problem with interviews is they're time consuming. Interviews can last anywhere from a half an hour to an hour and a half. A lot of them are done individually. So you are interviewing 100 applicants at an hour a pop. That takes a lot of time. And if they're not that valid, then what's the reason for them? Lots of times it's for a company to come across as being fair, right? Because everybody says, well, you know, at least I got an interview, which may or may not have helped at all. Another way of measurement in the industrial psychology world is the use of work samples, and they are exactly what they sound like. You demand, the task demand, to use measurement language, is to give the person an environment in which they demonstrate tasks that are actually from the job itself. And that environment is standardized, meaning that everyone who is assessed is assessed in this environment. So, and assessed exactly the same way. So it's like a simulation. It is actually a simulation. Let me see if I've got the example here. No, of course not. So I did mention the in-out basket. And what that basically is that the person sits at the desk and they literally have an in basket where there is a memo, there is a phone call message, there is an email, maybe there's actually a computer there and you're asked to open up, you know, an email program that's there and read the email. You might get a phone call, which has a standard script to it. And you're asked to respond to those three or four tasks that you've been given, the letter, the email, the phone call. And you are rated, probably on a rubric of some kind, on how you handled those tasks. So how you handled those tasks is the out basket. What did you do in response to those simulated job requirements? It is like a psychological test. However, it's a very specific one. It's measuring your ability to handle the tasks of the job. And oftentimes they are pretty complex tasks of the job, an email, a phone call. You know, that phone call could be about, hey, there's a fire on the assembly line floor. What should we do about it, right? Two people have already died. What are you going to do? So it can be about a very high level skill. As you can probably guess, these are very good ways to predict job performance. Well, why would that be? Because what you're asking them to do on the test is almost exactly the same thing they would do on the job. So that's described as a very close correspondence. You don't have to make a big inference from the test score to what it is you're trying to predict, because the test score is a simulation of actual work performance. And so these are very good predictors. If they're able to handle a fire on the assembly line floor in a simulation, then when it actually happens, they're much better able to handle it than somebody who screwed up in the work sample assessment environment. And people accept it because they see the relevance, unlike biographical information where, you know, you're asking, what does this have to do with the job? You know, when the interviewee comes in, the applicant comes in, you're basically asking them to simulate the job itself. And so people are very cooperative and willing to engage in that because they see the relevance. They do understand, oh yeah, this is going to show you how well I am able to do this job. One of the things that's required, however, is that this is basically an achievement test. They do have to have some experience with the task. If none of you have ever handled a fire emergency, and I ask you, on the assembly line floor, there is a fire, two people have already died, what would you do? You're going to be completely at a loss for that. People who apply for managerial positions in assembly or factories have had a lot of experience. They've often been on the factory floor first. And so they're very familiar with the crises and emergencies that can happen. So work samples are often achievement tests, if you will. As you can probably surmise, while it's an excellent predictor, these are very costly in terms of the time it takes to construct them, the time it takes to administer them, to score them, et cetera. And so it can be very, and get the materials too. You know, if you're creating the actual environment, you have to have a computer that's always available, no one else can use it, the desk, the phone, et cetera, depending on what it is you're putting in that simulation. And another reason is because they are often very specific to a particular job. And if you want to use it for a lot of the jobs at the company, you are making a lot of work sample assessments. And that can be also very costly. So when we think about all of the measures that we've already talked about, and we say, well, we would like to use all of them in one fashion or another, that's where assessment centers come in. They have simulations, work samples, they have psychological tests, they do interviews, et cetera. And so all of these measurements take place in this one location. And as I had mentioned at the beginning of my talk, this is a common hiring environment for industrial psychologists. They are hired to make sure that all of the measures are valid and reliable. And they conduct those measures and score them and write up reports and make recommendations to companies who contract with the assessment center to help them make decisions about the applicants. Once they're hired, what kind of training they need? Do they deserve promotion? Do they deserve pay raises? Should they be in leadership positions? Should they be fired? All of those kinds of important decisions. Companies will contract with assessment centers. And so there will be lots of things, as I had already mentioned, you know, an in-basket exercise, leaderless groups, I didn't mention that. Some of you are going to graduate school might experience this as part of your application. They will invite candidates to campus and give you a task to do with two or three other applicants. And they will observe how the group works on the task. Who took the lead? Did anybody, you know, take over the whole thing? Did anybody just sit there and not do anything? You know, a lot of things that they're looking at. Did you contribute in meaningful ways or in irrelevant ways, just have something to say, that sort of thing. Problem solving, depending on what the job is asking of the applicant, is that a position that does require solving problems? There may also be role plays. You know, pretend that you are a supervisor and you're giving me feedback on a poor job that I did. How would you go about doing that? Say you found me stealing money. How would you approach the situation with me? That kind of thing. As you can tell, if you're doing all kinds of measurement, you're going to be getting all kinds of data on all kinds of dimensions of the person that should be relevant to the job itself in order to be able to make the decision about the person. And that's the beauty of assessment centers. The more data, the better, especially if it's coming from different sources and it's different kinds of data. It makes for a more enriched and informed decision rather than one data point on one type of measure. So we already talked about the in-basket exercise, which is scored. You're not just observing them and seeing how well, you know, they did good or they did bad. There are dimensions on dealing with an email. How quickly did you deal with it? What did you say? Did you do it grammatically correct? Were you appropriate in your salutations? These days, professors are attempting to teach you how to communicate with them via email in proper ways so that you, when you are out in the world of work, you are sending appropriate emails. You're not just starting off with, hey, that's not a good idea. You should use a person's title, you know, dear Dr. Adair, hello, Dr. Adair, comma, give me the purpose of the email itself, whatever the question is, all the information that's relevant to the question. If it is a question about advising or any kind of relationship with the university, you should always include your campus-wide ID. And so you might be annoyed that professors are trying to teach you how to write emails, but that's the reason why, is because you are going to have to do it out in the world of work. And if you already know how to do it, then you're going to have a better chance of getting and keeping that job. Same thing with phone messages. I can't tell you how many times I get a phone call from a student who is freaking out about statistics homework. And I absolutely want those phone messages. I want to know so that I can help them, but they don't tell me who they are. They don't tell me how to get back to them. They just say, I don't understand the t-test, click. And I have no idea there's someone out there suffering with without me being able to help them at all. So again, a phone message. Hello, this is Stanley Smith. I am calling about PSY 220. I'm in your 9 o'clock section. I'm working on homework B, problem 3. Here are my questions. You can call me back at this number. Here's my email if that's better for you. If you're calling me by phone, I won't be home until after 5 o'clock, Tuesday and Thursday. Boom, then I know completely how to get a hold of that person. A little bit about how technology has assisted us. Sometimes interviews are done, they are videotaped, so they can be assessed later, not in the moment when the interviewer is paying attention to so much information already, but rather later when they can actually be scored by a standard rubric. Technology also enables us to do interviews distance-wise. You know, in this day of the pandemic, does selection have to actually end? No, we have Zoom, we can do interviews there. And so people don't have to fly in from California or Singapore or Australia for a half hour interview. They can be conducted through the use of technology. A lot of assessments have been computerized, and so they're able to be given on a computer or some other kind of equipment that standardizes the administration, that may automatically do the scoring, and certainly store a ton of data that used to have to be on paper in the past with, you know, filing cabinet after filing cabinet. There's also a certain type of testing called adaptive testing, which can be very easily done on the computer. And what that basically is when a person answers a question in a certain way, that leads to a particular second question based on the answer to the first question. It's commonly done with ability. If a person gets a string of items wrong, the computer will automatically generate easier items to kind of figure out like where their ability levels are. If an individual is getting a string of items correct, the computer will give them increasingly more difficult items, again, to see where their ability, what their ability range is. And so adaptive testing is often done in the world of ability assessment, but it can be done in other areas too. You know, depending upon what the person says in describing a situation, if they failed to mention how they resolved the conflict, the computer would automatically ask that question versus somebody who did mention the resolution, and thus the computer can move on to a different question. It can be very efficient. It can be cost effective. You don't need to have an actual person doing all this administrating and scoring, but it requires a lot of upfront work. Has to be programmed, all the errors have to be removed, or you're going to have some systematic bias caused by the computer because of a programming error. This last page, which you also have as a separate, it's at the end of the outline, but I also think it might be a separate. This last page is a list of resources, articles about each of the assessments that I've already talked about. And this list is also in the outline for the PowerPoint.